I have the honor of working for the North Carolina Department of Health and Human Services with Secretary Kinsley. And I am so grateful that all of you came out tonight and join us for a really important conversation. We're very happy to be here in Clarence County, and we're looking forward to hearing what you all have to say. And we're going to do brief introductions. And so I'll call up our panelists and they can speak for a few minutes. And then we'll open up the conversation to all of you, and you'll be able to come up and ask questions at this microphone in the center of the room. If you need me to walk a microphone over you, I'm happy to. Just raise your hand and I can walk a microphone over to you. And we're really looking forward to having a conversation. It's really important. Mental health is a top priority for the Department of Health and Human Services. And so we're really honored to have a conversation with you today.
I've been representing Cabarrus County for almost 6 years now in the North Carolina Senate. My background is legal and business, and I guess I have to call myself a politician now. I don't like doing that. I still feel like one. But I really appreciate you all coming here tonight, because I think one of the most tangible things we can do in government, and by the way, Pierce County, I believe, is a model of every level of government working together. So I just can't tell you how much I respect Steve Morris and the work that he's done, Van Shaw, our amazing sheriff, and we're here to serve you. We're not confused about who's serving you. So that's why we want to hear from you tonight. The reason I'm excited about trying to tackle the behemoth of mental health is because it comes the closest to the root cause of problems that we're seeing manifest in our society. It's easy to point to a false cause of something and feel like you're done. Mental health is tough. It's hard to Rubik's Cube to solve. But I appreciate Kody Kinsley, Secretary Kinsley. He's doing this every day. His intentions are good. He's going to be doing a great job for the state of North Carolina, for Bears County. So I'm pleased to be here. You're all doing heavy lifting tonight. This is not a simple issue, and we look forward to hearing what you have to say. Thank you.
I'm one of the chairs of Healthcare Appropriations, and I have a passion for mental health. And I just want to talk about my good friend, Senator Newt, last night. Yesterday afternoon, we unanimously voted for him to be majority leader of the Senate. Let's give him a big hand. And then my other two dear friends that are here, Representative Sasser and Representative Baker are both passionate about it too, and both are House Healthcare Chairs, and just so glad to see them. But folks, we have a huge problem with mental, and it's not just in North Carolina, it's across the country. And we'll be talking about, and I'm bad about wanting to put out a lot of statistics, I don't want to do that tonight. I just want to talk, and what we really want to do is hear from you and hear your stories and know, you know, your hearts. I talk a lot about mind, body, spirit, because as a believer, I believe those three are they're so entwined that we have to make sure we deal with all of them. But I always put mind first, because you know you have to be able to deal with things, and I want people to be able to have fulfilled lives and be able to take care of themselves and their families, and not be institutionalized and not have to be put in a jail somewhere. And I had a great conversation with your sheriff. He has a heart for it, and reminded me of something that we're going to take care of, and that's how to transport people that have mental health issues, because we don't want to add to their problems. So we're going to talk about a lot of things tonight, but we really want to listen to you, and I want to commend the Secretary. When he and I first met 4 years ago, first thing we talked about was mental health, and we both have a passion for it. I think that's why we're such good friends and talk so much, and we're going to have some really good announcements coming up very soon. So I'm excited to be here. Thank you for letting us come.
But it's really wonderful to be here. I'm so grateful to have such a showing. I know all of us are still coming straight from the gym to work out our turkey post-Thanksgiving. So really appreciate folks coming together.
Yeah.
I'll just say briefly, we want to try to maximize the time for questions. You know, during the pandemic, we saw a tripling in reports of anxiety and depression. usually in a given week, 1 in 9 people say, I feel lonely, low, or I feel a bit anxious. During that period of time, that number went to 1 in 3. Disproportionately among younger individuals, even though we saw a disease that was disproportionately impacting older folks. I think we've all experienced something like anxiety and loneliness. Many people, over 3,000 kids, lost a parent or a caregiver over the last several years. We're seeing these things play out with more than 250 people on any given day now waiting in an emergency department, having no place to go. That number is more than doubled for a lot of reasons. And these things get really complex really fast. And I tend to be the systems person who thinks about workforce and buildings and process and how all those things work. And transport's an excellent example of an issue where we need to be transporting people with dignity because they have a mental illness, it's an illness, not a moral failure. What has been really heartwarming about these conversations to me is that we have all, I feel like we have been able to hear feedback and input in your questions and in your thoughts that help us have a better and deeper and richer understanding of the problem. And the thing I hate the most is when we try to come up with a solution that isn't right size to the problem. And so I hope that you won't hold back. I know some of the people in the room, Gene, and so I don't think people will hold back, but I really look forward to the conversation. Thank you so much for having me.
I'm just so privileged to be here and appreciate Senator Newton and those of you who put this together and Secretary Kinsley who's traveling around. And for those of you who may not know, I'm actually a psychiatrist. I'm a physician and my practice specializes in child psychiatry. So I'm boarded in both child and adult. And so for me, this is my passion. And I have served in the legislature just since 2020, you know, coming in during COVID, and I can remember the first questions I got are, oh my gosh, what do you think COVID's gonna do to our, you know, mental health issues? And, you know, at that time, we didn't have data on something specific to this, but we did have disaster data, and it predicted exactly what we've experienced, you know, the isolation and the increase in substance use and the mental health disorders. And then our children who weren't in school then not being identified with their issues that they were fighting. And so that's the bad news. The great news is it has been, I can't tell you how exciting and hopeful the experience has been for me to work with the people that you see up here and so many of you who have been kind enough to turn out tonight. And so you see when Secretary Kinsley came in right away, he said, you know, it's mental health, and his actions have followed that every step of the way. And it's been a privilege to work with now Majority Leader Senator Newton, who I feel like he's been a mentor, but it's also been a good balance because his background and mine, hopefully we're providing a balance in terms of our service to this area. And then Senator Burgin, who, you know, has been there longer and was right away, you know, as soon as I came in, we got to talk mental health. And I'm like, oh, you're talking my language, you know. So such the vision. And then to have an opportunity to work with Representative Sasser, who's a pharmacist who knows this area, has grown up in this area, and boy, you know, fought for this regional behavioral health center. I mean, this was teamwork, including every one of you here. And I can't help with my history and experience to just give a shout out to Cabarrus County and to one of my former employers, PBH. And I know there's some cohorts in here who worked with me, who I see Anna. And I want to say, you know, we're going to talk about a lot of complicated issues, including Medicaid transformation. And there's nothing like having been in the legislature longer and watching this to recognize what an incredible achievement it was for then PBH to demonstrate that we could do managed care with the most difficult population, to show that managed care can work when you capitate services instead of fee for service, that can work in the severe mental health population with severe mental illness is nothing short of remarkable. And so everyone in here who has been involved in that has so much to take, you know, you should take credit for that, so much to be proud of. And that's really a touch point for me. Every time these issues get cloudy and every time we're kind of wrangling with, you know, we've done Medicaid transformation and kudos to DHHS, that went smoother than I think any of us would have expected, not without hiccups, but really a remarkable job. But we still, you know, that's the standard plan. Now we have tailored plans, we have foster care, we have a lot ahead. But again and again, I come back to the touch point that we showed we could do that. And we did it here in Ferris County. And frankly, I can't take credit for that. That started much before I got to PDH. And I was just, you know, lucky to be able to observe it and participate in it. So I think that we need to recognize that we can change things. We can make it better. I know that's why you guys are here. We're so excited to hear from you. And as was mentioned earlier, you know, Sheriff Shaw, we have so many people who are ready to work together and communicate routinely, like Senator Burgin was saying. And so I just, and you all represent it, you know, just post-Thanksgiving, here you are, because this is important. So thank you so much. Thank you for allowing us to serve you. And I look forward to the conversation tonight.
Good thing about being last in these things, I agree with everything they say. as Kristin said, I am the only pharmacist in the North Carolina legislature. So, you know, that makes me the best pharmacist in the legislature, the best living pharmacist. But, no, the mental health is the biggest health issue we have in this country. And I don't think there's a close second, because it encompasses so many things. Mental health is one of my passions. It is just an honor to be able to work with these three individuals. And I promise you, no one person in the North Carolina legislature can do anything without having support, not only on the Senate side, but on the House side. And Kristin and I, from day one, have just worked together. And I would give her all the credit for, you know, the $30 million that we were able to bring here for the mental health, the regional mental health. And I have to say regional because Stanley County can throw me under the bus and I tell them that I got $30 million for the Ferris County and they didn't get anything. And then the $1 million for the Sun Project. I mean, Ferris County is just, you know, doing great things, but the problem is just enormous. Kind of my passion and my expertise, if I have any expertise after 48 years of doing this, is the opioid crisis. And we were able to put $30 million of state taxpayers' money into the opioid crisis this past year, separate from the $750 million that the Attorney General was able to get for. So we're doing everything we can do to attack these issues, and right now, if you look at just the opioid deal, with everything we're doing with fentanyl, looks like we're going backwards, but that doesn't mean we're not going to continue to meet it head on, and the state's aware and working hard. So I'm just honored to be here tonight, and thanks for you and for the invitation.
You know, we just actually a few weeks ago convened a group of folks at the governor's mansion to discuss how do we really go after root causes around violence, right? And, you know, unfortunately, the numbers on kind of chronic violence and injury issues tend to lag. It takes a long time for all those tragedies to be added up. But I think we all, and we've touched on this, feel that as people are kind of returning and re-entering the, you know, tempers are shorter, you know, the ability to cope effectively is less seen, you know, that I'm sure everybody's Thanksgiving were more interesting this year. But a lot of things are unfolding. And the conversation was really interesting. It was about 20 people from all different walks of life, folks that focus on veteran suicide, people who are trauma surgeons in hospitals because we see this violence showing up every day in emergency departments. And where we got to was that we really have to tackle violence from what I believe is a more public health lens, right? Taking kind of akin to how we think about traffic accidents, right? There isn't a one answer solution for trying to reduce injuries from traffic accidents, right? And over 30 years, we were able to really reduce the number of people who got in accidents and people who were injured from it because we added a layer of approaches. We didn't say there was one size fits all. We met people where they were, you know, and we tried to change behavior over time, right? So seatbelts and speed limit signs and airbags for folks who don't wear seatbelts and better care and earlier interventions and, you know, an array of different things to try to bring public health strategy. And I believe that we can do the same thing around violence. And I think that we can walk and chew gum at the same time. We can talk about firearms, right? We tragically had this mass shooting in Raleigh that was absolutely heartbreaking. And I'll tell you a brief story about my team because they're amazing. But our awesome, the chief medical examiner, you know, had to take custody of those decedents, people who had just lost their lives, worked through the night to perform autopsies on 11 other people because we have a first in, first out approach. Every life is sacred and respected. And then worked through the weekend to work on those decedents, five individuals who tragically lost their lives. And then 2 days later, a two-year-old crawled into the back seat of their dad's trunk and shot a gun and fired and killed themselves. And then we had to take that body as well. And so I think I say that story to say violence is unfolding in a lot of different ways. And I think it's really important that we talk about trauma-informed work in communities, but that we also have to talk about safe storage options that look like a lot of different things based on need. Everybody wants to protect their family. If you need quicker access to a firearm, then there's a firearm safe, right, for responsible gun ownership. We have 4-H staff there talking about safe shooting training. It's just as much about how to respect a firearm as it is about leadership and civic duty and responsibility. And so we put a paper out documenting some of that conversation, and we happen to share it around, and we're going to continue that work and happy to fold more trauma-informed work into it. I mean, the last thing I'll say on this is that, you know, in response to kind of every tragedy event, I often go back to the principles of trauma-informed care because, you know, the core one there is how do we respond in a way where we're not continuing to traumatize people? And that is what so often happens, as we say, in the cycle where people running to their corners and screaming about the solution that they think that we're just traumatizing each other further and creating a path forward. I'm very interested in that.
And one of the focuses, touching on what you said, that the Child Fatality Task Force is really looking at. And I do want to say that it's been very concerning. The New England Journal of Medicine recently put out a paper. It's been concerning that the increase in firearm abuse in terms of homicides has been marked in children and adolescents. And that's really something we're focusing on. And that is one of the issues Senator Burgin and I both sit on top of the Fatality Task Force. And so safe storage of firearms is definitely one big issue, but we're really tracking the data around suicides and homicides and what might be contributing to that. But I think, you know, trauma-informed care, as we talk about foster care and all these, you know, it intersects. And that is the one thing about these conversations. They are multifactorial and they do intersect. And so if we can make progress in one area, the ramifications of that being quite significant. So thank you for that.
You know, I just will say, I call this often, you were kind of talking about, you know, how do we balance community-based services and facility-based, where all that money in the health system? I think I would challenge us to broaden even further. And I call this the kind of long pocket problem, right? So think about, you know, the sheriff who, you know, will inevitably have a number of people that need capacity restoration that will end up coming to one of our state psychiatric facilities, you know, where probably detention daily rate is $88 a day to $100 a day. My daily rate at the state psychiatric facilities is $1,300 a day. And, you know, if I could do more community-based capacity restoration to look different, then I'd be able to serve more people in our state psychiatric facilities that are currently in emergency departments in Atrium, Vermont, and everywhere else, right? You know, we've got folks crowding it. So I think one of our biggest challenges, and look, I mean, I'm the healthcare guy, so I'm always going to tell you it's all health. But if we really do look at a lot of the drivers here, there's so much money that we can save. There's so much money that we can put in the right place. I mean, the other lens, sorry, just sitting here, so I'm looking at you, is, you know, nationally, and this bears out in the state, 60-70% of people in jail have a substance use disorder or co-occurring mental health issue, right? If we can, you know, it's something that we worked on, the opioid response, and I've heard from sheriff after sheriff after sheriff saying, I can't arrest myself on this problem, right? And so we're not, we don't break the cycle of every time, and the amount of money that that costs the judicial system by trying to break the cycle and getting into your community-based treatment program, that's great. But the problem is, and this has been the problem with a lot of things over the years, is that when one part of these programs starts to work well, the other part of the program doesn't see the savings. And this is where I think we have to think more creatively, and this is why I'm glad to have this coalition of people here to think about where do investments in health save money in our prison system? Where do investments in certain community budgets that are done locally for programs to build resilience in communities save money in the ED costs, right? Because that, and that's the, this wrong pocket strategy that we've got to continue to work through.
And first, thank you also for that question. I'll give you a perfect example. We have two hospitals in Hardy County where I live. It's one system, the two hospitals. I got a call from the CEO one day, and he said, you know, we've got a little 13-year-old girl here that's been here for 94 days in the emergency room. So we can't find any place to take her. And so we have, you know, we've exhausted what we can do, and we really need some help. So I got the secretary involved and other folks involved, and we got her moved to a facility. Because she got through that many days not getting any treatment, and literally in the emergency room, not in a room somewhere off, but in the emergency room. And you know, he said she had Thanksgiving with us, Christmas with us, New Year's with us, her first period with us. And he said, you know, the nurses are providing for her and taking care of her. Folks, that's not exactly North Carolina. And a year ago, I got a bunch of information from different hospitals. We could have saved $200 million that year if we had not let people stay in the emergency room from involuntary commitments. And I've got some hospital friends here, and we're going to fix that too, because someone sitting in an emergency room is going to cost about $2,500 a day. And Secretary hit it exactly right. Hardy County Sheriff Wayne Coates, who's a good friend of Sheriff Shaw, said that you know, it's $88 a day in Hardy County Jail, and it's about, well, depends on which hospital we look at. I always say 1,400 because I think, you know, he says 1,300 for our three mental health hospitals. So somewhere between 1,300 and 1,400. So really what we have is a housing and logistics issue. So where to put folks and where and how to treat them. I want folks to treat them. And then the other thing I don't want is, we'll talk a little bit probably about foster care a little bit later on. I don't want us to send folks out of state. We need to, this is North Carolina, we need to treat our folks here and keep them in state. And on any given day, we have kids that we're sending out of state, both in foster care and other services. So, you know, I don't want us to dwell on all the problems because I believe in being very positive and upbeat. But I think I'm a business guy, so I don't look at spending money, I look at investing money. And I want to invest in these, especially children, who are one day going to be the folks that are going to be working in all these jobs and running for political office and working in law enforcement. And I want to make sure that we give them the absolute best chance to live fulfilling, productive lives that they can take care of themselves, take care of their families, and have added value for society. But we can't do it by just putting people away and housing them somewhere. And you know, another conversation, I don't know if we're going to get into the IDB situation or not, but that's something we're going to be dealing with and talking about. So the Secretary and I met with Senator Burgin today talking about some mental health issues, and I know Senator Burgin is committed to it. And I talked to Speaker Moore last Saturday, and I know he's committed to it. So all of us are committed to working on the big things. I told Senator Burgin once, I said, give me something real complicated to work on, because I like to work on complicated things and try to figure. Not that I'm a real smart guy, but I just like to try to figure those things out. And I know that Senator Newton, he and I have had long conversations about a lot of these things. He's committed to it too. So, we can fix this, but we need everybody's help. We need everybody praying about it. I should have brought a little bag of these. I give away these Pray First bracelets, and I think a lot of it starts as a believer. I think a lot of it starts. We need to be praying about stuff. We need to be praying for each other. We need to be praying about our city. And we need to be praying about these children, especially, because I want them to have a fantastic life in North Carolina.
I don't know where this came from, but I know I can change it. So I was like, they're going to write into law that I can change rules that easily, and then we'll do it. We'll get on. And make sure by the time we're done that I have your contact information so we can look at it. I do want to emphasize, though, that we have to tackle the pay issue, too. Because, this is a really tough time to work on. You just beautifully summed it up, right? I mean, Bojangles is offering health insurance. Some days I have days, or I'm going to go work. So we can't just make changes to qualifications. Right? I agree with you. This doesn't make any sense to me, and I'm going to have to make more sense to try to figure out what's going on. But we got to have conversations about, at this time when we have the tightest labor market in a generation, how do we make changes to try to make it easier for folks to come into the workforce and to where it's not just about passion, but there's actually payment and compensation too. But we also we've got to tackle these great issues as well. And this one's particularly complicated. The last thing I would say, I care deeply about our LMNCOs having sufficient numbers. And they got to focus really hard on making sure that they're not only building but sustaining these networks with rates that make that possible. And we've got to work on them.
I was up in Asheville recently and visited a facility called October Road. You've all heard of it. They treated about 800 people, and a lot of them are homeless. And something that, from talking to doctors all over the country, and just met a doctor that retired from Pennsylvania and moved to North Carolina, and he's an emergency room doctor, but deals with opioid treatments and all. And I was asking him about people that are using illegal drugs, and and I heard this across the board from many doctors, that about 75% of them have an underlying mental health issue and that they're self-medicating. But one of the things that's really interesting is they, in the Asheville area, they have a lot of homelessness. And when I was driving around in Asheville and on my way to this facility, I saw numerous concentrations of tents on different lots of people. And so as I was touring the facility, they were telling me that they have groups of people that are living under bridges around Asheville. And what they're doing, they have doctors and nurses there and clinicians there and psychiatrists there, is they're going out and treating those people where they are and then trying to get them stable. And one of the nurses that I met there that day had just gotten back from going out to visiting with a man who lives under a bridge and giving him a long-term injectable for his mental health. And I'm a big proponent of long-term injectables. I think that as I've studied that whole issue and I've talked to law enforcement, and law enforcement, I asked the sheriff this question earlier. I said, what percentage of the folks incarcerated in your jail have a mental health issue? And he said, 50% or more. And my sheriff tells me the same thing. So folks, it's a lot of those issues, but as I've interviewed folks and met with folks, a lot of people that can function if they take their medication properly either don't like the way it makes them feel, that's one of the complaints, or they're fine, when they're taking their medicine, so they quit taking their medicine. And so I think we've got to look at more ways to treat people and to get those underlying issues dealt with so that they can not be homeless. And as we go into winter, I always worry about this. I was talking to some folks in Asheville, and I'm gonna be on a conference call on Thursday with some folks in Asheville, because you know, those folks, we don't need to let them stay out in the cold, and we need to get them in a better place. Our veterans, I represent Hardin County, but a lot of Fort Bragg is in Hardin County, so we deal with a lot of veterans issues, and we are funding some veterans homes. We're funding some veterans treatments in the local hospitals. We got money for our local hospitals to do treatments for detox and mental health and opioid addiction. But the homelessness is a huge issue. There's some folks that tell me they just don't want to, you know, they don't want to be somewhere. I talked to a guy in my own county that said, I said, I can get you in a facility or get you set. But I don't want that. I just want to be left alone. My staff was telling me Monday morning in our staff meeting that there's a guy that's living kind of off the grid, off of a walking trail in Dunn, North Carolina. And they started taking him clothes and supplies and leaving him on a bench. He finally talked to him this week. In the past, he wouldn't even talk to him. And that man needs help. And so we're trying to build that relationship. A lot of this is relationships. You know, it's hard to treat somebody if you don't have a relationship with them. It's easy for me to come in from out of town and tell people, you ought to do this, you ought to do that. But I'm more of a weeds guy. I want to get in and try to figure it out, how to do it. I don't have the answer, but I'm looking for it. And I'd be happy to talk to you about it and see what you think. And that's really the purpose of what we're trying to do, is we want to hear a lot of different things. Now, there's a lot of people that are doing a lot of good. I've seen programs across the state. I think October Roots doing a good job. There's a facility called Healing Transitions that's on Dorothea Dix campus that I think is doing a great job. And so we're trying to duplicate those, find out what's working and duplicate it. But one size is not going to fit every community. We're doing some work in Lumberton now. We're doing work in a lot of the rooms. And you know, I'm really worried about a lot of our rural areas. And Representative Baker and I talked about this. 31 counties don't have a psychiatrist out of 100 counties. But at Chapel Hill, we have 100 psychiatrists that are all at Chapel Hill. So, you know, we've got to get things done. I'm going to be running legislation, you know, Senator Newton will let me get it all done, to deal with providing more psychiatrists, more primary care physicians. You know, we have 20 counties that don't have a pediatrician, 23 that don't have OBGYN. And I don't know if there's still, there was three, I don't know if it's three or two now, that don't have a primary care doctor. Folks, this is North Carolina. We're the ninth most populous state, considered the best state in the country to do business. And those are not good numbers for us. So I want to talk to you right after this, if that's okay.
Thank you for that question. I think it is a complicated question, and I think that you touched on something that is really important, which is essentially being there where they are. Because I think that, you know, Charlotte had a big initiative a few years ago, you know, we're going to end homelessness, and what they found is what all these studies find, and that is that the skills that allow somebody to survive on the streets are skills that don't easily transfer to a box, right? And it makes us feel better to say, here, have a shelter over your head. And of course, that's reasonable. But instead, you know, walking alongside them. And so I think, as Senator Burgin was saying, I think looking at each community and using those resources and those relationships. So one of the things that I've tried to get a better understanding of here, and I think is starting to make some inroads, is our FQHCs, right? And so had a lot of conversations with Don Holland and Robert Freeman, who are able to integrate into that community and then tell us, well, what do they need, not us telling them what they need. So I think that's a critical starting point. I think the other thing, to Senator Burgin's point, is utilizing resources. And so one of the things that we're doing with our FQHC here is using one psychiatrist who is then, you know, in various other regions, but is always available to follow those patients. And I think you start with trust. I think that's one of the things with Medicaid transformation, when we have healthy opportunities, right? We're trying to we're trying to see, you know, it is certainly getting that treatment, but that it is, it's always a trick. When people feel good, and we've all been there, right? It's not just homeless people, it's not just people with mental health disorders, right? When we feel good, we don't want to take our medicine. And so, you know, so understanding the normalization of that, but so medication is key, but also, you know, workforce, right? What can they do to feel productive? You know, and there's, you know, of course, as a psychiatrist, have to think about that, but, you know, what makes their life valuable and worth living, and understanding what that is and capitalizing on it. Again, not us choosing, but empowering them to choose in a healthy manner and walking alongside that.
Sorry, can I just add one thing to what has been said as far as thinking about how do we help support people currently experiencing homelessness. I think we also, you know, announced prevention, down to cure. You know, it's, you know, obviously there's a lot of housing costs are wild right now, and that is really hard thing for reality to deal with. And a lot of our supportive housing programs for people with chronic mental illness and who are aging, you know, are really challenged in supporting them. But also, you know, I think history offers a really important lesson here, which is thinking back to the 60s and the 70s, and then again the 80s, there was a big movement to close large institutions that provided psychiatric care, and then the 80s, community mental health centers. And, you know, I think that more community-based care, local care, closer to home care is great. But unfortunately, a lot of those larger facilities and larger institutions were closed before the other care was there. And we saw, you know, a lot of folks transition into homelessness from those facilities. And we saw a lot of people become what is now the community mental health center, which are the jails. And as we think about creating the world that we want to create, where we have more community-based services for individuals, whether it's behavioral health or disabilities, as we make those investments to, in the face of really challenging workforce issues, to build that continuum of care that it needs to be, we have to make sure that we don't destroy the system of care that we currently have, and that we continue to cornerstone and give people the right choices.
Easy answer from a senator. We actually passed it out in the Senate. We expanded Medicaid. We recognized the financial benefits for the state. We recognize that this is a window for those financial benefits. It might close. We also recognize that the population we're talking about are not ne'er-do-wells. These are people that are working. They're just making too much money to qualify for Medicaid. So, long story short, we decided it was in the best interest of North Carolinians to expand. Our colleagues in House had a different answer.
And, you know, we did pass it, and we were ready to do it. But let me tell you, the people have asked me when we travel, why haven't we done it? Well, we had to do something called managed care for Medicaid before we could do this, because we were having these wide swings where we would have a year where we would have a $200 million deficit in Medicaid. And so the numbers were going back and forth. But once we went to managed care, we've leveled that out. So we know, you sent me the number, like 300, and how much a month we spend per person now? $348 sticks out in my brain. I don't know if that's exactly right. Maybe one of the providers, if they're here, sharing that. But anyway, we are now spending so much per person per month with the PhDs. So that now is fixed. So that's why we go to the next stage, which is Medicaid expansion. But I just want to share something with everybody, because the numbers get real interesting. Right now, there are there's 2.7 million people on Medicaid now. The Secretary and the Governor say there's about 600,000 that we would add under Medicaid expansion. Folks, that's going to be one-third of the population of the state of North Carolina on Medicaid. Now, any of you that run a business, think about a third of your folks being paid on benefits but not working. And we've got to have a long-term solution for that. Now, Secretary and I have been working on something, and I put it up to him to sell it to get it done. I talked to folks at the White House three different times and once in person, because I want to do a program where if you're on Medicaid, We, through Medicaid, will pay for free community college for you and provide child care. So you get an associate degree, and we're going to get make sure you have a job when you get through. I don't think Medicaid was ever designed for people to go and stay on it for the rest of their lives. I think it should be a temporary thing where we're helping people get to where we can do what I talked about a while ago, be self-sufficient, self-reliant. So I'm all in. I want to do anything we can to get it passed. And the other thing is we will get about $1.5 billion of new money, of which we could spend $1 billion of that on mental health. Now that's a game changer. If we could take as a state spend $1 billion on mental health, we'll make a difference. We gotta be smart on how we spend it. I mean, my prediction is next year, second or third quarter.
What he said. when you have the opportunity to be around people that are passionate about what they do, they're intelligent, they're problem solvers, but I think already, hopefully everybody has determined how complex this issue is. Okay, it's not that nobody cares. It's not that, you know, that every individual, especially with the opioid crisis, nobody fits the models. That every person is entirely different, you know, coming with different backgrounds, different mental problems, so on and so forth. So now we understand how complex this is. It's not one issue because it's not just people that need more help with mental health personnel. It's child care, okay? It's nursing homes. It's hospitals. When we have a shortage of personnel in there's not a single that I'm aware of entity out here that has too much help. I mean, everyone signs everywhere. So we thought we had solved, you know, all the problems of the world when we put $200 or $300 million into nursing homes last year and raised most of those people. And I understand a lot of it didn't get to the employees, but that's a whole other problem. But then the people that were making $15 wanted to know where their $4 or $5 an hour raise was. So sometimes you create more problems than you solve, and that's kind of where we're at. Because I don't think we can give, you know, 5 million people a $5 an hour raise on, you know, from the state of North Carolina. But wanted to brag on my senator down here. We passed a bill thanks to him last year on this long-term injectable thing, allowing pharmacists to administer long-term injectables. Now it's taking a little time. But, you know, pharmacists do a really great job with vaccines and that kind of stuff. It takes a little extra training to do the long-term injectables and stuff. But the biggest problem that we have with that is once we get all the pharmacists trained and they can do it, who's going to pay for the medicine? And that's one of the 500 reasons that we need to expand Medicaid. Okay, we've got to get these people covered where the medicine can be paid for. And we're trying to solve that problem. And I promise that some of us on the House side are in total agreement with what the Senate's done. But it's not easy. It's just not easy because there's some arguments out there that are valid, and we just got to get everybody on the same page. So thank you for your question, and thank everybody else for the questions. You know, they're all relevant, and we're taking them all to heart.
And I would just like to add, I appreciate the question, and I think if you can allow me a medical kind of paradigm, and that is that the details are critical. And so if you say to me, should I have an antibiotic? And I say, well, okay, what's the antibiotic, right? So do we want Medicaid expansion? So much it's a complicated question, and it's very important. And I will go ahead and say, I stood on the floor and said, our citizens deserve for us to look at this because it has changed. As Senator Burgin said, since we did Medicaid transformation, we're in a very different position in North Carolina. Medicaid transformation allows us to consider Medicaid expansion in a very different way. That being said, since Senator Newton provided the opportunity. The Senate bill, so if you said to me, do you need a, you know, should I, do, what about an antibiotic? I have, you know, great. Well, I don't just give you an antibiotic. I look at your entire medical history and what other medications you're on. So when a bill comes across, then that says Medicaid expansion, if it's not just Medicaid expansion, we need to look at everything else in that bill, and we need to do a risk-benefit trade-off. So with all due respect, you know, I think that the healthcare bill that came across that included Medicaid expansion included some other things that I was concerned about myself personally, which I don't have any ultimate vote, but myself, I was personally concerned about some of the other healthcare issues in that particular bill. That's why I would say, personally, I believe we need to look at Medicaid expansion, and we need to look at it in a clean bill, because our citizens deserve it, and it is complicated. And our, you know, we have to do the right thing by our citizens, health-wise and fiscally. We do not want to bankrupt the state by saying, yes, great idea, how are we going to pay for it long term? That's not fair. It's not fair to our children and our grandchildren. So do I, you know, so I very much want to look at that, but I want to look at it with the risks included. So if there are other health issues put into a bill, those are just as important, and we need to make sure it's a good bill the whole way through.
Thank you so much. Well, a couple things. One is, you know, we have been traveling across the state, really, I think, gearing up for a long session. Right? So, long session will start, I predict it will take 27 months in the process of crafting the budget. And a lot of the feedback that we've been hearing, well, you'll see these conversations play out in joint legislative oversight committee hearings that the legislature has, where we talk about issues. You'll hear about it in committee meetings, you'll hear about it in a lot of the policies that we put forward to propose. Look for the governor's budget that'll come out in February or March that will likely highlight some real meaningful investments around mental health, around individuals with disabilities, much of which I think you'll hear and see reflected in the conversations that we're having. I mean, everybody is very busy and they live very busy lives. So I don't expect everyone to get fully involved in the policymaking and political process. But what we're sharing with you is that these conversations are going back to make sure that we inform the work that is happening there to shape those policies. And we'll be really intentional at the department to continue to have engagements and conversations and town halls and, you know, open forum. You know, through COVID, you know, we all had to communicate really quickly. We all had to be on the same page. And the thing that we learned, that in that moment, everybody was so focused on one thing, it was really easy for us to do that. And so I just said, well, let's have a conference call with every big health provider once a week. And we started opening up these lines, and we had 1,000+ people screaming at me at the same time. So, but we learned, and look, and I would frequently tell people, I don't have the answer, but we would loop back the next week. So I underscore that to say, I deeply understand the importance, not just of listening, but of having the feedback and making sure that via a variety of channels that we just talked about, that we do that, and we'll stay committed.
And just a follow-up comment. I mean, the discussion about Medicaid expansion is a great example of the complexity of the legislative process. It is the forum of last resort. So we've talked about a regulation in here that needs to be changed. That can be changed fairly quickly relative to a piece of legislation. The legislature is designed simply for things not to pass. But we pass bills all the time, right? But what you've got, I mean, you've got very, you know, very dedicated people with different life experiences bringing those to bear on the content of potential Medicaid expansion. And Dr. Baker is going to see things that I'm not going to see in that bill. So I would never say that the House is wrong in not passing Medicaid expansion. We're more humble than that. We realize they may have seen some things that we did not consider. So we passed it. We thought we had a good bill. The House disagrees. Hopefully we'll come together with an even better bill. But it really changes the face of North Carolina when we pass any bill, and we want to get it right. And the system is slow, but it provides opportunity for tremendous input from a lot of different perspectives. And everything we do, by the way, is available to the public in the sense of every committee, you can listen to it. Some of them you can watch online if you want to, but you could, if you wanted to, you had all the time in the world, didn't have a day job, you could follow everything that we do on this very issue.
I'll talk just a minute about one of the roadblocks to services, a certificate of need. Right now, one of the things I want removed is all the requirements on both psychiatric and mental health and opioid, any restriction. And if somebody wants to come to North Carolina and open a bed to treat somebody for a mental health issue or an opioid treatment, I want them to do it. And we should have anything that stands in their way. We need to encourage it and try to help them do it. So that's one of the things that we have put in our bill with some changes to the certificate of need. I served on the SHID, which is a state health coordinating council that does the state health plan every year. I was appointed and served on that for a number of years. And you know, as I watched the process for certificate of need, I realized that, you know, a lot of things got turned down on the first blush, ended up passing. I think over 90% of all of the requests ever made for certificate of needs eventually got passed, but it would take on average at least 2 years, about $500,000 to do it. And folks, I'm a business guy, as I said, that's not a good use of money. And so we're trying to streamline that. During the election cycle that we just went through, somebody came up to me and asked me, Jim, how many bills have you passed? And I said, I have not passed one, because one person in either of our chambers cannot get a bill passed. You know, it takes a group of people. And you know, I can make a decision in one of my businesses and we can change it today. But in the legislature, you have to go through the process. You have to go through the committees and, you know, talk to everybody, convince everybody it's a good idea. I was frustrated at first, but after I was there a few months, I realized that's how you don't want us to be able to pass bills fast, because you would not get a good bill. Sometimes you don't get a good bill anyway. But the process is what it is, because it makes sure that we have a check and balance on ourselves to get better legislation and to do well. It's a time-consuming process, and you know, all of you probably heard about making sausage. You know, you like to eat the sausage, but you don't want to see it made. That's kind of what they say in the House and the Senate. You don't want to have to go through the whole process with the bill. We want results. And folks, as a business guy, I'm looking for results. The process takes too long for me as an individual, but I understand why it is the way it is.
I think that getting more providers, behavioral health providers, is incredibly important. We've got three priorities of the department: behavioral health and resiliency is the one we've really been talking about tonight. The second one is a strong and inclusive workforce. These things are equal to connect them. A couple things that we are doing in the workforce space. So one is, you know, as we shifted to our managed care transformation, you know, part of that for kind of broader analysis and specific to behavioral health, because they've been in the MCO infrastructure for some time, which was really raising the bar when it came to network advocacy. And we continue to look at this both for standard plans and the tailored plans, which we're now working on launching, to make sure that we have sufficient number of providers in those networks to serve people, and then pushing our payers really hard to do whatever it takes as providers are negotiating for rates to make sure that they have sufficient folks. Now that's hard, because if we already have a lot of providers essentially either retire or leave the place, they're not negotiating, they're not coming in. And so the pressure, you know, the market pressure is to actually get more money to draw more people in are not sufficient. So that's part of it. The second piece is really, unfortunately, lost a lot of people on the pipeline. And so we have been working to try to build more awareness and paths into the behavioral health space. Fixing rules and regulations like this helps that. But also, you know, we did a program for all the HBCUs and the serving institutions the other day, trying to tackle stigma around becoming a behavioral health provider, both by talking about what we can do on their campuses, ranging from collegiate recovery to other strategies to help support them in their college experiences, but also get their ideas to help get them on a path to becoming a behavioral health provider and trying to do more there. The third thing I would say, and part of this is more of a public campaign issue, is that, you know, part of what we have to tackle is that behavioral health for too long has been kind of relegated to the adjacent to healthcare field. And we have got to return the esteem. And to me, there is no more important thing than people working in the behavioral health field. You know, Senator, you talked about going after the root causes of so many other issues in our communities. We really can support people's whole health and well-being by serving their mental health. We see the cost of managing their diabetes come down. We see their contributions to their communities increase. We see their tax dollars that they pay increase, right? Like, it is the magic wand that we need to go after. And we need to remind every provider, many of you in this room, who spend every day trying to support someone that has a chronic illness and a condition that you're managing through, that not only are you doing really important work, you are probably doing the most important work for a functioning society, and we have got to work together to change the conversation in that direction.
And I just strongly agree with that, and that's one of the reasons I went into psychiatry is, all right, if your mental health is not okay, the rest of it doesn't matter. But to your question, I think it's a really valid question, and as a provider, having worked in both the public and private sectors, I would say you're right. Medicaid doesn't pay, right? And so, but just like some of you all who've spoken who are, you know, working in the level threes or PRTS, part of the reason you do it is because you have a passion for it. And so you're not looking for the most money, but you've got to, you know, you've got to be able to maintain. And so I think that one of the key things, I think that money does matter. And so I think one of the things that has excited me about Medicaid transformation is that if you can do some of these wraparound services, your patients will keep coming back. That's part of our problem, right, in Medicaid, is that the no-show rate is very high. And so, and but there are reasons for that. So if we can address, it's not because they just don't want to come, right? So if we can address that, then we can keep people healthier, right? Then treating that Medicaid population is not the onerous, undoable job it was prior to that. So I'm hoping that those healthy opportunities are gonna provide that. Other things that we're doing now that I've seen develop over my career is some co-location, so that you can have your mental health people call in to your primary care office, whether it's pediatrician or internist. Of course, that's kind of one of the ideas of this holistic care. But for consultation, then it's not as expensive for anybody. Then you're getting better care for every patient. Because again, when we talk about access to care, one of my questions is, what kind of care? What level of care? The care I want my family to have, or just any kind of care? Because I want people to have the kind of care I want my family to have. And so we need to really think through the details in that and what we're doing. And so I think it's important to put that out there. There are providers of all kinds, not just physicians, not just nurses, not just people who run these different facilities, who look at, you know, have to look at, all right, can I afford to do this? Can I keep my business running? And so I think that's a very valid question. And so I think these are the things that we're trying to do. Is the healthier we can keep people, not only is it better for them, it's less expensive for our system, but it's a long term, right? So it's keeping them out of the ER, keeping them up front, routine health care, all those kinds of things that again, if you look at a private population versus a Medicaid population, sometimes those routine cares are not at all the same. So if we can do that up front, then our long term, we'll be able to keep the people who, like so many of us in this room, want to work in this field.
I would just like to add, you're getting at some of the complex problems that we face. We can't push a button and say we're going to expand Medicaid 600,000 people. We don't have enough providers to take care of the people we've got out there now. They were three of us House Health Committee people that went to Orlando about 6-7 weeks ago for a 3-day long weekend seminar. And I promise you, every state in the nation's have the same problem we are. So it's not that North Carolina can go to South Carolina and hire 50 psychiatrists, or to Virginia, or to California, or the, you know, Montana. Every state's facing the same shortage of health care personnel. So, again, I hope you're seeing some of the grills in the room that we face every day. It's very complex, and it's not, why don't you push that button? It's problems, you've got to come up with a solution to those problems, and that doesn't do any good to expand 600,000 people on Medicaid and have no providers to take care of them.
Thank you for your answers. The second part, maybe, is are there any creative solutions being pondered right now to help those children that are in the interim so they are not decompensated?
I just want to make sure I'm answering your question. Can you give me specifically what kids you're talking about?
Adolescents, youth, and we're seeing more and younger children, elementary age, middle school children coming up with a lot of health issues, behavioral health issues. So what efforts are being made, if any, to service them in the meantime until we can find providers that can treat them specifically or any other options?
Thank you. So earlier this year, we convened a group of folks from county and state levels, nonprofits, providers, LBMCOs, and we came up with a multi-sector child and family action plan. And if you haven't seen that, I encourage everyone, I think for those of you that have given us email addresses, we can add that on the follow-up email to make sure everyone has it, in addition to the violence prevention plan we talked about earlier. But in that plan, we outlined about 14 different strategies that range from, you know, A, better awareness of existing capacity across the state and where it is. We see often there's a lot of unused capacity, and right now the answer is not, you know, the only answer is here's a list, make all the calls you can. We need to, you know, use technology to give people better access and better awareness. And we also talked about more crisis services and doing more mobile crisis for kids in a different way to do earlier intervention. We talked about trauma-informed schools and community work. We have been, we pushed that forward. We did not have success in the short session in getting any of the funding, unfortunately. But we have continued to push forward on the things in that plan that we can push forward, and I just mentioned some of them. But there's a lot more that we could do that, in addition to providers, supports, and testers, there's many levers here, and that plan, I think, outlines a lot of the things, especially for kids that are in this kind of DSS involved behavioral health needs phase, and of course, we have building on that.
You know, one thing we did do in the budget last year, we actually expanded coverage for new moms up to 12 months, and just a lot of other things. The statistics are that 52% of all the babies born in North Carolina were paid for by Medicaid, were born on Medicaid. So that's one thing you got to remember. And then something that we're, the Child Health Task Force, we just had this meeting a couple weeks ago, the number of infant deaths in the Black community is over double what it is in the White and Hispanic community. And so think about that. And one of our goals is we want to reduce total infant mortality by 50% in 2 years. And some of the things we're looking at are like doula services, other, you know, getting involved quicker with women. I talk about, Secretary and I talk about this 4-3s. You know, I want to be involved in the first 3 months of pregnancy, in the first 3 months of birth, first 3 years in third grade. If we could monitor children during all of those stages of their life, I think we could have great outcomes. But one of the things we were talking about, head medical person in your office, and I asked the question, what is the number one reason for death certificates for an infant that dies early on? Or at birth, and it's low birth weight. The low birth weight is a direct result of some of the things that the doctor was talking about. And but we've got hospitals that are closing their maternity rooms. So we've got, you know, a lot of people, a lot of doctors don't want to be in there because of the high it's very expensive. I'm in the insurance business, and one of our businesses, and you know, the cost for malpractice insurance is terribly high for you and all the other doctors in that field. But we see a lot of these things, but there's a lot of things we got to zero in on. And the first thing is dealing with those folks that the state is providing the care for, because I think that's the first group we can talk to. Plus, I don't know if any of our girls are here from United or Blue Cross. All of them are looking at more services like doula services and everything from midwives to doulas, and then trying to monitor that care for a longer period of time.
Couple things on this. One, first, you know, we've worked a lot on peers and building out peers, I think family peers and supporting of that work. It's another frontier for us to do more on. You know, we just launched 988. We've done really well with our ability to answer and manage folks in crisis and do some initial handoff. I think about how do we build that out more to provide family navigation services, right? Often what we have is when someone goes into a psychiatric point of crisis, you know, the entire family is traumatized from that experience. They don't know where to go or who to start with. And I think there's some, you know, great experience among family members. It's a great opportunity for us to try to lessen that burden as people come into that process. You know, you and I have talked a bunch about individuals with disabilities and their family members and what respite care looks like. And right now, respite care in this state is really a tragedy. You know, unfortunately, for a lot of reasons, things dwindled over the ages, and we know that there are people who take advantage of trying to figure out respite any way that they can. And we've got to make sure that we can be folks, and that's what I'm really excited about as part of our Medicaid transformation effort, the work on 1915 I services, and I'm getting into like career Medicaid speak, but finally having federal dollars where we can pay for respite care and other home-based services for people that may not be, but there's no provider checks, and how do we build that out and what do we do? So, you know, there's a lot of work to do here, and we can't just constantly lean on natural supports without also supporting natural supports. I appreciate you bringing this up. I mean, I think that, you know, the time to expand Medicaid was, I believe, 10 years ago. But I'll take December. And I think that everybody's coming to work in December. And so I think, you know, that's what I'm asking for from Santa. And I really hope that it could come through. But I deeply respect the commitment of the people up here, other members of the General Assembly, and I'm so glad of where we've gotten to. You know, every life, every opportunity to support folks, and every issue that we talked about tonight, I just want to hammer home a few of them, right? You know, when there's no money for nails in a community, the Ace Hardware closes, right? The truth is that one of our biggest problems in mental health care is that mental health issues and poverty are co-occurring. When people have chronic mental health issues, they cannot, when you hear voices of people that are not there, it is really hard to go to work. Yes. And therefore, it is really hard to maintain your health insurance. And if you were in care with a provider, now they're treating you, if they can, in a way that is uninsured. And so you're not just balancing as providers. You know, the truth is a lot of folks with serious mental illness are getting care, but they're getting care on shoestring budgets, well-intentioned providers, right? So I'm not just interested in, yes, I'd love to expand providers, but the truth is that a lot of people already are getting care, and we just need to pay those providers for the work that they're already doing. And Medicaid expansion is to the tune of $521 million a month. Every month we lose $521 million. I mean, when the meter is running and I have dodged into the grocery store, I move faster, and that's $2 an hour, right? Like, we have got to get this done, and I deeply, deeply hope that we all can, because it is far too late and the opportunity is far too close.
Yeah. I hope that you feel heard. I know that our leaders up here were listening. And we're excited to continue hosting these town halls across North Carolina. So if you had a question tonight and you were able to ask it, we are planning to keep traveling and keep coming around. So you can eventually, we're going to go to a place soon, have a website where you can track that, and you can join us. So we hope to see you again soon. Thank you again.